right, good morning, everybody. It's a beautiful day. There's such great energy already this morning. Some of us have been in Sunday school together, and we've had good fellowship out there. There's donuts out there. We're always so thankful for that. An owner from 7-Eleven brings those for free, by the way. Just gives them to us. Isn't that incredible? Just our community. So awesome. So my name is Jamie Swope. I'm our family ministry director, and I'm super grateful to worship with you today. I do want to just mention a few things that are happening, and it's a lot. So the announcement page is in your bulletin. If you don't grab those on your way in, you're missing out. There's some good stuff on there. So everything's important, but I do want to highlight that after church today, we're having our International Day Planning Committee. And if you didn't, like, there's no sign up, you just stay for the meeting. So see Jerry for that. That's going to be a great thing to start planning. So join us for that. And then I also want to point out there's a really good service opportunity. You can help us work on our grounds, help the trustees with our work days. So if you're the kind of person you're like, look, Jamie, I'm not going to lead a Bible study. That's a little intimidating, but I can swing a hammer, or I can paint something, or I can pull a weed, then this is a really good service opportunity for you. So there's two Saturdays coming up, Saturday the 2nd, and then the 16th of July as well. So it's a 8:30 to 12:30 shift. You come, you can contact Linda if you want her to know that you're coming so that she can plan enough service opportunities for us to help here at the church. I also want to mention that we've got some fun planned next weekend because the Brants, our missionaries who we sponsor, are going to be visiting with us next weekend. So the fun starts on Saturday. You can come to the Farrell's home in Damascus for a picnic. The Farrells are waving their hands if you want more information about that. Their email is in the bulletin so you can get their address if you don't have it. If you've never been to their house, you're so welcome. Just show up and come. Bring some food if you've got some. I think it's a potluck. And you will love the Brants and getting that extra time with them. They're incredible people. You will be inspired and refreshed from encountering them. And then Sunday morning, all of our Sunday school classes are combining, except for children. Oh, no, children have a special thing too, but the adults are going to be meeting in the fellowship hall with our youth, with the Brants, or with one of the Brants, I should say, to just hear about what God's doing in their lives. So that's just a really great time to come during the Sunday school hour. Make sure that you're there. And then Howard Brant will be preaching too. So it's a whole weekend of the Brants next weekend. It's going to be awesome. And then summertime at Neelsville. You get a little tickle here in the bulletin. You see that we're planning these really cool worship nights. We're calling it Saturday Nights on the Lawn. There's two dates scheduled. Our first one's on July 16th, which, by the way, is my husband's birthday. So make sure you say happy birthday to him that day, because he'll probably be there helping Mimi with the bounce house. So you know what our birthday plans are for his 40th now. So we are going to be having a little bit of a message. It'll be more interactive than normal. It's not meant to replace the worship service, but just a really good, like, devotional time, fellowship time, and worship time. It's going to be like acoustic worship, really fun. So if there's inclement weather, then we'll just do it in here. It will be fine. So with that, I also want to mention that if you're new, if it's your first time today, we would love to get to know you better by having you fill out our guest card. There's some in the pews if you didn't get one from the greeter. If you turn that into one of our greeters, we have a gift bag for you just to say that we're so glad that you came. So make sure you do that before you leave today. And now I'd like to go ahead and get us started with our call to worship. So if you would please stand. Oh, hold on. This is my fault. I knew that was going to happen. It was a busy morning. Thank you. We like to stand and sit a lot anyway, so we're just warming you up. This is Courtney Midlum. She has an update for us, and I'll let her share. Sorry.
Good morning, church. I have an exciting announcement to make. I'm going to read real quick from Leviticus chapter 19, verses 33 to 34. When a foreigner resides among you in your land, do not mistreat them. The foreigner residing among you must be treated as your native born. Love them as yourself, for you were foreigners in Egypt. I am the Lord your God. I share that with you because I have an update from our Afghan resettlement ministry team. A small team started in January, and I think you've heard messages from several of them in the time up till now. And I'm not sure how I got blessed because I'm not actually on that team, but I got blessed to be able to share with you all that we are on track to receive an Afghan refugee family on or around July 5th. This team has been working since January, praying for the Lord's discernment, praying for the Lord to open the doors that should be open, knowing that the Lord had a family in mind for us. And we are excited that we are and have entered into a sponsorship program with the Ethiopian Community Development Council. They go by ECDC, and they're an international resettlement agency. And we're going to work with them to receive this family, again, around July 5th. We have temporary housing accommodations set up for the family in the next several weeks that they will that we'll be able to stay in, and then we're going to help them settle into an apartment. And now we are ready to receive household good donations. So those of you who signed up on our Sign Up Genius, we are ready to receive those, and we would love to have those donations by next Sunday, July 3rd. There is a box in the back in the narthex. If you aren't able to bring them to the church by July 3rd, you can just let me know, and I'm happy to come pick them up, or you can drop them off at my house. And we also have some donations still needed on the sign-up. So if you're interested in helping to contribute, you can meet me and Joanne in the narthex after service, and we can help you sign up for something. And we have another opportunity for service is we need to clean the apartment, the temporary housing. We need a couple people to help this week on Thursday or Friday. If you have a couple hours and you're willing to do a little scrubbing and freshening up of an apartment with Joanne, she would love the help. You could just reach out to her. And if you signed up to donate furniture, we don't need the furniture donations quite yet. We're still waiting for that rental apartment to be available. And we'll just keep you posted on when we're ready for the furniture. So as we continue to seek the Lord and trust in His timing for each of the details, we do ask you to please lift up this family that is going to be settling in our area so that we can show God's love and welcome them and help them to settle in this community. Thank you.
Well, that's an exciting update. That was worth interrupting the call to worship, wasn't it? So sorry about that, Courtney. I knew I was going to forget. I said, wave me down. I get in a mode. So I'm just glad that we are a church that is about helping the refugee, that is about coming alongside those who are vulnerable. What a blessing it is to be part of a group of godly people who want to honor God by giving sacrificially. So if you're like, what list, how do I give? I believe that house display that you see will have some more information about that for you, and we hope that you join in on that. And now, let us stand for our call to worship. This comes from Psalm 33, 1 through 3. Shout for joy in the Lord, O you righteous. Praise befits the upright. Give thanks to the Lord with the lyre. Make melody to him with the harp of 10 strings. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully on the strings with loud shouts. Praise the Lord. Let us continue praising with one of my favorite hymns of all time. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee.
Now
praise today. We thank you that we can stand here singing with joy because of who you are, because you are the God of glory. You are the Lord of love. We thank you for your great works, for the ways that you love us every single day, for your great mercy for us sinners who are not worthy of the love that you have poured out on us in your Son, Jesus Christ. We continue to give you praise and glory as we sing to you now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I love this line from the last song that we sang. Here in our weakness, you find us falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne as we sit now and confess our sins to the Lord. Can you just picture the Lord on his throne, so willing and ready to listen to our confession now? Let's say this together, followed by silent confession. Lord God, your love for humankind, present in the beginning of all things, extends throughout history and touches even my life. Your love sees failings and forgives. Your love feels pain and wipes away our tears. Your love knows grief and comforts the sorrowful. Your love sees sin and still loves the sinner. Forgive us when we fail to live lives that reflect your love. Forgive us the many times when we take for granted all that you have done for us. Transform us through your Spirit and empower us to serve you this day and always. We ask this through Jesus, our Savior and lover of our souls. Amen. Let us stand for our assurance of pardon. This comes from Hebrews chapter 2, verses 14 through 15 and 17. Since the children have flesh and blood, he, Jesus, too shared in their humanity so that by his death he might break the power of him who holds the power of death, that is the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death. For this reason, he had to be made like them, fully human in every way, in order that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in service to God, and that he might make atonement for the sin of the people. Thanks be to God. And stay standing now for our confession of faith. Let's say this together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now it's time for our offertory so that we can give our offerings to the Lord. I want to remind you that there are four ways to give here at Neelsville. The plate will be passed. You can mail in your offerings. You can text to give or give online. And we are so grateful for that. We're talking today in our hospitality class about how everything that we have really belongs to the Lord, right? Everything that we have is his. And we know that it's a gift to be able to give back to the Lord what he has already given to us. So with that, we now have our offertory, How Deep the Father's Love for Us. Lord, we thank you for these gifts that your people have given back to you. Would you multiply these gifts for your glory, for your kingdom? Thank you for the provision that you have given for all of us in our homes, in our lives, for our families. And Lord, we pray for provision over this church. Would you help extend the ministry of Neelsville now through these offerings? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, you may be seated. And now is the time for our children to get a blessing. I'll be praying for them. And then if we have any children here who are second grade or younger and checked in for the worship and play zone already with Miss Melissa, you're going to follow our friend who's holding the yellow sign to go back to worship and play zone today. So let me first pray for you. And then when you hear Jesus loves me, that's your cue to head on out. All right. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for every child who is a part of this church. We love them and we know that they are gifts. And we just pray, Father, that you would be with them today as they continue to learn about you, that they would grow closer to you. Father, we pray for their parents, for those who are the family members who are raising them. Would you empower them with your Holy Spirit to disciple them, to raise lifelong followers of you? And we love you so much and thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Extra blessed today to have Dr. Sam give us the word of God and preach it today. It's a great scripture, John 15:4. So we're excited about that. I want to tell you a little bit about Dr. Sam. Now, he's been a member here since 2005 with his family, with his wife Evelyn, but I want you to read in the bulletin a little bit more about him. As you'll find out, he holds two doctorates. He is a man who loves the word of God and is excited to preach the word of God to us today, and we're so grateful for the ministry he has done. You'll read too in here. It says, Sam is credited to be one of the founders of the Ghanaian Presbyterian Church, Christ the King Congregation in Greenbelt, Maryland. What a cool thing to plant a church like that and then to have him part of our fellowship and be so passionate about the word of God. I love our church family, and I love that we can learn new things about each other. Perhaps you didn't know that about Sam. You walk by him every Sunday, didn't know that he has done that for the Lord. So it's going to be great to hear from his heart today. And I would like to pray for him as he prepares to give the word. Lord Jesus, thank you for Dr. Sam and his passion for the gospel. Holy Spirit, will you continue as you've been preparing him for this message to speak through him now? Will you also open up our hearts to hear your word today? We love you. We thank you for this brother in Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I'm excited to stand before you this morning to bring you the word of God. Our theme this morning is, how are you connected to Christ Jesus? How are you connected to Christ Jesus? And our biblical text is taken from John 15:4, and I read, "Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you abide in me." Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, and O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. What does it mean? What does it mean to abide in Christ Jesus? That word abide appears at least 121 times in scriptures, in multiple forms of the word. Abide, abiding, and abided. But it's considered an old word in our language. We prefer to use alternative substitutes like stand by Christ or stick with Christ. A person who abides in Christ consistently cultivates godly character through the application of biblical values. Christ compares it to a farmer who grafts the weaker branch to the stronger vine for better yields. So he says, I'm the vine, and you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he is the one that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. And that's found in John 15:5. And so Christ gives us the formula for bearing much fruit on our Christian journey. He says we have to stay connected to the vine. In other words, we have to stay connected to Christ. Now, God's servant Job is a perfect example. Job chapter 1, verse 1 says, there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. And that man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. So even when Job lost everything, that's what he said. I left my mother's womb naked, and now return to God naked. The Lord has given, and the Lord has taken. May the Lord then be blessed. A lot more can be said about Job, but we know how the story of Job ends. After losing everything, he lost everything. God blessed Job, as found in Job 42, verse 10, says, and the Lord restored the fortunes of Job when he has prayed for his friends, and the Lord gave Job twice as much. The Lord says he gave Job twice as much, having lost everything. Now, Job did something unique, something very special, something unequaled by his peers to forge his godly character. He was obedient in the bare sense of the definition. He practiced obedience in the bare sense. He practiced obedience. He never faltered or failed. He knew nothing of our Christ, but he knew the Lord and was determined to follow him. Now, as Christians or followers of Christ, we face many challenges in our faith journeys. We are charged, however, to walk in the light as Christ is the light, as found in 1 John, the first chapter, verse 7. He says, and he reads, but if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sins. So any honest Christian will tell you that it's not an easy path. There are distractions in our faith journeys, and those lies pull us in different directions. For instance, they are the lights of the main street with all its glittering attractions. They are lights of the broad street with its promise of an easy life. And they are lights also of Wall Street with a promise of wealth. And of course, lastly, there are the lights on the strip in Las Vegas. And those of you who have been to Vegas, which offers all the worldly distractions in the Sin City, as they call it. See, all these alternate lights have their glow to lure us away from Christ in our faith journeys. So the question is, how do we keep our focus on Christ amidst all the glittering and clashing noise of the world? In other words, how do we stay connected to the vine or Jesus Christ? Now, the psalmist said, blessed are the people that know the joyful sound, who walk in the light of your face. Psalm 89:15. But how do you recognize the joyful sound of Christian obedience? And Isaiah gives us an admonishment here about the house of Job to walk in the light of the Lord, Isaiah 2:5. Now, how do you stay focused on the light of Christ and stay in the spiritual path of obedience? That's a mega question. We will admit that on occasion, our connection to Christ has been interrupted like the electrical panel. And let's admit it. We know it's not an easy thing, because we've all failed a few times, if you are going to be honest with ourselves. And we'll admit that on occasion, our connection to Christ has been interrupted. So like the electrical panel that provides power to our homes, our Christian spiritual panel who provides power to ourselves, because it's wired to Christ. And this is where we have to be careful. But in our past, we've thrown more than a few spiritual breakers. Sometimes, a worldly surge leaves us in the dark. And before we even have the chance to reset, we find ourselves fumbling around for the switch that will turn the light of Christ back on. It takes effort, real effort, to stay connected to Christ. And I'm not going to lie to you, and as you all know, because a branch has to protect its connection to the vine. And I'm going to give 3 tips on how to do this. There are so many, and as you go through Bible studies and reading and other things, you see that we are introduced to several forms, several manner of behavior that is expected of us as Christians to get wired to Christ. But for the purposes of this sermon, I'll give you 3 tips. And the first one is read the manual. Read the manual. And what's the manual? The manual is the Bible. God went through a lot of trouble to communicate to you. He compelled divinely inspired men to write his instruction and make it plain. And that's the Bible. His manual is therefore a perfect treasure of heavenly instruction. And since it reveals the principles by which God would ultimately judge us, we would do well for ourselves to read it and follow the tenets in the Bible. We all experience times when we feel distance from the Lord. Maybe we've gone through the loss of a loved one. Or maybe we've lost a good job. Or maybe our good health. See, in those times, our faith goes through a shakeup, a test, and we quickly find out how connected or disconnected we are to Christ. And I can call that feeling, or I'll call that feeling, a state of helplessness or a Christian roller coaster or mental gymnastics, because you are in that whirlwind fashion and then you can't even think right. And you begin even to, you know, question yourself. Where's your God? For instance, in the year 2013, the Harris Poll found out that 74% of Americans believe in God. That may seem like a pretty big number, right? In research terminology, you say significant, quite significant, 74%. But consider this shocker. What's surprising is that our faith in God has in the same vein fallen by 8%. And this was conducted by, you know, Harry, the same pollster, who gave us that assuring number of 74% of Americans believing in God. So this suggests that someone among us, somewhere, is not reading his or her Bible. Now, the Apostle Paul told Timothy, he said, don't just read the manual. Study it. Study it. So there's a difference. You can do a cursory, you know, reading through the Bible, and then you can do an in-depth study. And that's what I think the church offers the opportunity in small groups and, you know, other groups, so that you digest having read, you know, the Bible, to see other perspectives, what it means. Because sometimes you can do your own myopic kind of interpretation, and that's not good enough. So the fellowshipping with one another helps us grow. Now, there are myriad of scriptures to encourage us on our faith journey. Now, Christ's admonition to abide in him is only one of them. And that's the only segment we're taking today, abide in him. Now, if you study the Bible to show yourself approved unto God, here are a few more that will strengthen your connection to Christ. Especially at those times when you feel the distance ocean between yourself and your Savior, when you feel you lost, right? That's assurance. You go there, go to that book, the Bible, the manual. It has a lot of scriptures. And by discussing with other covenant partners, you get that assurance that you're not lost, that you're not alone. See, when you are feeling separated, fearful, or anxious, Peter says, cast all your cares on Christ, for he cares for you. And that's found in 1 Peter 5, 7. Paul again says, instead, be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. So when you find also that you're having a relapse from sainthood, the Word of God reminds us that God demonstrated his own love for us in that while we were yet sinners, he died for us, as found in Romans 5, 8. What an assurance. We go about our businesses, doing all kind of crazy things in our faith journeys, and then we have the assurance that Christ Jesus died and carried all our sins on the cross. And if we believe in that, then we have the salvation. So this is where sometimes atheists would all poke fun at Christians. Oh yeah, you the guys, you know that's wrong, and you do it and you say you're repenting and you're praying and you're forgiving, so you keep on just doing it, right? Well, I'm a Ghanaian, in the Ghanaian language, you know, very, very proverbial. We say, commit a sin, and then you have the assurance that you can get on your knees and prayerfully seek forgiveness. And by your faith will drive you that, yes, you are forgiven. See, when you are confused and don't know which way to turn, again, Proverbs 3:5 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. He didn't say trust in the Lord. He said trust in the Lord with all your heart. With all your heart. And don't lean on your own understanding. On your own myopic understanding, shallow understanding. Remember, your connection to Christ will be weak unless you read the Bible. Christ says, take my yoke and lean on me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I found in Matthew 11, 29 through 30. Now the second tip I want to offer you today. In our faith journeys, is stay in your lane and practice what you preach. Stay in your lane, don't meander, don't wander, and practice what you preach. Now, it's okay to read the Bible, but you've got to learn how to apply your spiritual knowledge to your everyday life in order to limit those untimely spiritual breaks that trust into the periods of darkness, or that trust you into periods of darkness. You have to work hard to keep yourself on the straight and narrow path. It's not an easy journey. And the only way to do that is to apply what you've read to how you live. You don't just read, study, and get all the directions given or offered us as Christians and do something else. You've got to apply them to how you live. So application prevents exasperation. See, when you read a manual and apply its standards to your daily living, you'll discover the things that harm your spiritual walk. And that's the truth. It convicts you as you read prayerfully. The Bible is a powerful tool to correct us in our faith journeys. So you learn how to stay away from those places, positions, and perspectives that tempt you. And to give you a few of those distractions, for instance, stay away from immorality. Yes, those pornographic images, those obscene images, they are immoral, and they will corrupt you as Christians. So stay away from them. Now stay away from corruption. Don't corrupt your Christian faith so that you become a good exemplar. And our best exemplar is Jesus Christ. Now stay away from vulgarity. Oh yes, our tongues are laced with cursive words like you motherfucker, son of a gun. Just get rid of all those language from your tongue as Christians. In your faith journeys, if you want to stay connected to Christ, and stay away from lying and cheating. Stay away from the love of money at all costs. When I say love, it's okay, we all look for money to take care of our families and businesses. But it says, stay away from the love of money at all costs. That means idolizing money. See, from where I come, I come from a West African country known as Ghana. And unfortunately, there's a new pandemic of lust for money by some unscrupulous few individuals who are occults, now who are using human powers to concoct juju for money at all costs. See, this rather unfortunate trend known as Sakawa, S-A-K-A-W-A, in our language, you know, it's their belief. I don't know. And they say it makes them get rich quick. And at least that's the belief of those perpetrators. So when I mean don't idolize, you know, money, those are the kind of things I'm trying to draw a man's. So you get a picture. Get your priorities in order. Practice what you preach. If the label on the jar says jelly beans, it shouldn't be filled with pebbles. Similarly, if the label on the outside says you are Christian, and that's a big one, you are an ambassador of Christ, then you shouldn't be filled with sin. Now remember, secret sin is still sin. There's no sense trying to color it or reclassify it or camouflage it or conceal it or cover it. It's still a sin. And you can't perfume it or polish it. It's still putrid. Sin stinks. You can subdue it and try to seclude it, but it's still a sin. And every sin, you see, unfortunately, that opposes God exalts Satan. And if it belittles the cross of Jesus, it also dignifies Satan. And one theologian, Cotra Davis, you know, in his usual flowery language, says, sin is sweet. Sin is very, very sweet. And its sweetness, it's what has lured many Christians into shame. Because, see, once you get on that track of sinfulness, you feel good about yourself. But, see, there's somebody up there watching you. So if you don't quickly turn around by reading your Bible to get that admonishment, then very soon, shame. And that's when you try to be apologetic. But you've done it. Now listen to what John, 1 John 1:7 says. He says, God is light, and in him is dark, is no darkness at all. So if we say we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not tell the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. See, when we allow the light of Christ to penetrate our soul, now if the jar says jelly beans, then that's what will be found inside. Jelly beans and not pebbles. Now let me use, and because I'm Ghanaian and I said that kind of language is very proverbial and rich, literally, I have a tendency, you know, I've learned English, so you learn a little bit of, you know, the Ghanaian culture. Now, when parents give birth to a newborn, right, normally they allow 7 days of the child's, you know, existence. And the belief is that the neonate who comes out is studying his surroundings to see whether there's any life. So if he lives for that length of time, 7 days, then it means, yes, he's loved. And then he decides to stay. So on the 8th day, that is when the child is then named. And it's not like you just call any ordinary person, you know, with so much baggage, you know, in his trail to come and lay the person. No, because he's an unblemished, you know, neonate. So you look for a distinguished somebody, you know, from the family with unblemished character to do the naming. And that's how it's done. You hold the baby in one hand, and then you introduce 3 sips of bland water into the baby's mouth. And as that is being done, you tell the kid, the baby, that the water signifies life and truthfulness, so that as he grows up, his yea should be a yea. Good. Then after you introduce that afterwards, you introduce another simultaneous sips to the baby's tongue. Well, some people will use salt water for the difference, or honey, or the non-Christians will use alcohol, mild alcohol. Again, the significance is that it signifies no, bad, evil, sin, and that should be shunned at all costs in the baby's growth process. So even in ancient culture and customs and tradition, sin and evil were recognized. And every individual was encouraged right at that neonatal stage to be good and a useful citizen, to have a connection with his creator. See, when your mind seems fixed on what is not pleasing in the sight of God, in our faith journeys, then brethren, it's time to pause and examine the motivations behind your moves. Is temptation causing your thoughts to drift? If that's the case, resist it. Resist it. But have you taken a detour from this straight and narrow path? Keep your mind as the old saints used to say, stayed on Jesus, our example. The word says, let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. In other words, you've got to stay on the spiritual track. Don't meander. So if you stay in the lane called Christianity, the word promises that just like Christ, you become obedient unto death, Philippians 2:5. So the practice makes perfect. See, I'm sure you've at least had one occasion or so when you had to jump start your vehicle. Well, that's if you're using an old vehicle, right? Especially if you drive an old one. Because batteries do drain down if you don't care for them properly. So similarly, if you don't read your Bible to stay connected to God, as Christians, your faith lives die. Your faith lives die. But there are warning signs along the way to let you know your spiritual battery is running low. In my typical Akan language, again, we say T-I-C-A-W-O, T-I-C-A-W-O, T-E-A-S-E, T-I-C, A-W-O, A-W-U-O. Translated in English means you are a living dead Christian. You are living dead. And it's a very serious state of oneself as a Christian, because these are some of the visible signs that go with a state of oneself as a Christian. Or simply put, you are disconnected from Christ at this stage. You are a living dead Christian. You're not reading your Bible, you're not following the admonition and details and examples, the many trillion stories that the Bible, so rich, that fulfills you. You're not making use of any of them. So then what is the use of you as a Christian? You are spiritually dead. You are bankrupt. Maybe you are being tempted to sleep on Sunday mornings when you have to come here and fellowship with your covenant, other fellow Christians or covenant partners to have your spiritual batteries charged. Maybe on your you are dwelling too much on problems. So instead of your blessings, you're not celebrating enough the goodness of Christ in your life. We are also fortunate and blessed this morning, okay, to have risen up from bed and had opportunity to be here in the sanctuary this time, listening to God's word. Others weren't so fortunate enough to see this day, and we take that for granted. Or maybe you are too tired to read your Bible, just a few verses and pray before bed. Or maybe your attitude towards your church has changed. Maybe your participation in church activities has also changed. Or maybe your support of the church financially has changed. But remember, the church operations run on our finances. So if you change and you're not supporting the church, you know that you can ask yourself, which track are you on? Which pathway are you following? There are all kinds of red lights that something is wrong. Signs that your spiritual battery is dead and needs recharging. You definitely at this juncture need to recharge your joy by reading your Bible to stay connected to Christ. No one had a better excuse to be in a spiritual slump than Apostle Paul. Remember, Paul was a hunted man, and Herod and his cohorts wanted him dead at all costs. But Paul did not let that stop him. He was determined to finish the course. So he still headed to Jerusalem, because our text says he was bound in the spirit to finish what he started. Can we say so for ourselves? When we started out as believers, we promised to abide in Christ, to be obedient to Christ, to trust in Christ, and be devoted to Christ. So, brethren, when you feel yourself slipping and being disconnected from Christ, there are areas of your faith that may need to be recharged. Please read the Bible and apply its teachings to your life for a jump start to stay connected to Christ. And finally, thirdly, say, don't focus on your failures. Don't focus on your failures. Instead, celebrate your successes. If you celebrate your successes with Christ, eventually you become hardwired. Hardwired to his spirit. Spiritual power failures will become a thing of the past. So those things that distracted you will become nothing but a fading memory. You will find yourself godly rather than guilty. Excuse me. And your faith deepen and your Christian character enhance. You wake up one day and realize that sin no longer reigns in your mortal body. As found in Romans 6:12. You'll be lifted from the gutter to glorious, miserable to marvelous, pathetic to precious. And you'll be free from fear and frustration, doubt and desperation, care and condemnation, shame and separation. Because you have fought a good fight of faith. And not only fought it, but won. And all because you've learned what it means to abide in Christ. You'll forever be connected to Jesus. And you'll be unshakable, unmovable, steadfast, and anchored in the Lord. See, there will be no more grief, guilt, or groaning. There won't be any more despair, defeat, or darkness. And no more sorrow, sadness, and suffering. And I know there are a few saints here in the sanctuary this morning who are unshakably connected to Christ. Now go ahead, brethren, and celebrate your spiritual success by praising the Lord at all times. Praise him for your godly character. Praise him for your humble spirit. Praise him for your faithful commitment. Praise him for your compassionate heart. Oh, yes, in the Bible, celebrate, because you are persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate you from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And we read this assurance from Romans 8:38. So go ahead, covenant partners, and praise the Lord, because your faith has dissolved your doubts. Your faith has satisfied your longings. Your faith has dried your tears. Your faith has brightened your days, supplied your needs, and enriched your life, because you are forever connected to Christ. Celebrate, because you have Jesus, the Christ. And glow in his newness to win souls as disciples for his work. Be the shining stars and ambassadors of the Zion at Neelsville Presbyterian Church, Germantown, Maryland, to draw more souls to his kingdom. Yes, celebrate, for God is good all the time, and his kingdom and word shall reign forever. Brethren, stay connected to Christ always. Amen.
Amen. I love this verse, and the word has been preached well today. Thank you, Dr. Sam, for that blessing. Now we're going to pray together, and then we'll follow up my congregational prayer with the Lord's Prayer. Father God, we lift up so many people in our country and world that are going through trouble of many kinds, whether that be mental health crisis, economic issues, natural disasters, war. This world is broken, and for many people, it's a scary place. We pray for your comfort, for your sons and daughters to go forth and be salt to this earth, to be healing balm. Would you help us look around, Lord, in our own communities to those people who are hurting, that we could be ministers to. And I do pray for our covenant partners, Father, those who are part of this church community who are suffering in any way, those who need jobs, who are praying, Father, for provision, those who are struggling with health concerns and other fears. Father, we just pray that they would be ministered to, that they would be honest about their concerns in this church family, that they would have accountability and love and support, and that we would be the church. Lord, we just pray that as a church, we would be able to minister to this refugee family that is coming. Will you help us to meet every single need that they have? Will you stir us up in a beautiful way to meet those needs? And now let us pray as the Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now let's stand and sing.
Thank you.
Let's remain standing for the charge and benediction. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit remain with you always. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.